try to begin and welcome you all. And it's my great pleasure and honor to welcome as our speaker tonight, Professor Michael Hunter from the Birkbeck College, University of London, a well-renowned specialist of intellectual history in the 17th century, the editor of Boyle's works and correspondence and diaries, and the president of International Society for Intellectual History. And Michael Hunter's talk tonight will be on the Enlightenment rejection of magic, skeptics, and their milieus in 18th century England. Please, you have the floor.
Okay, thank you very much. It's very nice to be here. Very nice to be through. So I'm going to read it. On the 12th of May, 1786, Dr. John Ferrier read a paper to the Manchester Literary and Philosophical Society entitled Of Popular Illusions, and particularly of Medical Demonology. Ferrier was a typical Enlightenment figure, the premier physician of Manchester in his day, who not only had an extensive and successful practice, but also played a leading role in measures aimed to improve sanitary conditions in the city and to provide humane treatment for the insane. His paper, published in the Society's memoirs in 1790, gave a learned account of beliefs in witchcraft and related phenomena, remarking particularly on the passion for mysticism which characterised many Renaissance and early modern thinkers. As he approached his own day, Ferrier commented in almost shocked terms on various examples of the credulity that he was surprised to find still in evidence, including the notorious convulsions at Saint-Médard in Paris in the 1730s, which showed how illusions scarcely credible may prevail in the brightest periods of science and art. Coming forward to the time when he was writing in the 1780s, Ferrier similarly instanced the widely publicised magnetic cures of Franz Mesmer in Paris and the dispossession of George Lukins at Bristol in 1788, on which he commented, "Is it to the credit of this philosophical age that so bungling an imposture should deceive seven clergymen into a public act of exorcism?" Ferrier's amazement at the continuing prevalence of such beliefs was interspersed in his paper by piecemeal explanations of why people were susceptible to such erroneous views, and he was later to develop a systematic account of one such belief system in his essay Towards a Theory of Apparitions of 1813, often acclaimed as a pioneering work of its kind, in which he argued that apparitions and related phenomena could be attributed to purely physiological causes. They were mere illusions based on the shreds and patches of past sensations. In recent studies of the fortunes of magical beliefs in the 18th century, on the other hand, the views of skeptics like Ferrier have been rather sidelined. Instead, emphasis has been placed on the very beliefs and practices which he found so out of place in his enlightened age. I'm thinking particularly of works like Paul Kleber Monod's Solomon's Secret Arts, The Occult in the Age of the Enlightenment, or John V. Fleming's rather less impressive The Dark Side of the Enlightenment, Wizards, Alchemists and Spiritual Seekers in the Age of Reason, both published in 2013, which argue that occult thinkers attached themselves to the ethos of the Enlightenment and that such beliefs flourished as much as ever during that period. Indeed, such books perhaps raise the question of how the Enlightenment ever gained its reputation as an age characterised by its scepticism about magical and related modes of thought, suggesting that critical attitudes like Ferrier's, which once seemed so commonplace that they were almost taken for granted, deserve fresh scrutiny in their own right. Now, I suppose it's in the nature of occultist commitment of the kind that Monod and Fleming have studied to leave profuse archival traces on which historians can fasten. But that does not prove that it was the preoccupation of more than a minority at a time when most may have rejected such beliefs. Indeed, this makes it, if anything, more rather than less necessary to elucidate the alternative sceptical position. On the other hand, although Ferrier's comments are indicative of the way in which a dismissive outlook became increasingly predominant as the period progressed, at an earlier date it is more elusive. Even if the Enlightenment saw an increasing naturalism and an increasing reluctance to accept the possibility of supernatural visitation of the world of the kind which magical beliefs took for granted, published critiques of such beliefs are surprisingly rare. One example is provided by Francis Hutcheson's famous historical essay concerning witchcraft of 1718. But it's revealing that he himself rather deprecatingly described this work as being about so dark and unpopular a subject. Although in his seminal Religion and the Decline of Magic of 1971, Keith Thomas had no doubt that the 18th century saw increased scepticism about the beliefs and practices that had flourished in the early modern period, and that he there encapsulated under the word magic, including witchcraft, magical healing, apparitions, and other intercourse with spirits. Thomas nevertheless described this change as the most baffling aspect of this difficult subject. So in this talk, I want to try to throw new light on it by considering who was in the forefront of rejecting such beliefs in the early 18th century and why. What sort of people were axiomatically hostile to magic and occasionally took the trouble to say so, even if this was a period when, in practice, most people simply ignored the subject? What can we learn about the affiliations and rationale of such articulate scepticism? A reconsideration of this may help us towards a better understanding of Enlightenment thought. I'll begin by considering a figure who well illustrates the occultist milieu about which Monod and Fleming have written. In this case, the Somerset naturalist John Beaumont, who died in 1731, whose historical, physiological, and theological treatise of spirits, apparitions, witchcraft, and other magical practices appeared in 1705. Beaumont's book provides an encyclopedic account of beliefs in the existence of genii, or familiar spirits, from antiquity to his own time, arguing the reality of such phenomena against those who were sceptical about them, and modishly organising his material in terms of each of the five senses by which such supernatural beings could be apprehended in an evident attempt to align his ideas with those of John Locke. Not only did Beaumont provide an account of the experiences of such spirits on the part of others, he also told of his own encounters with them. On the first occasion, he only heard them. They called to me in my chamber windows, rung bells, sung to me, and played on music, etc. Subsequently, however, hundreds of spirits appeared, and I saw some of them dance in a ring in my garden and sing, holding hands round, not facing each other, but their backs turned to the inner part of the circle. Thereafter, he was mainly visited by just two spirits, both in women's habits, they being of a brown complexion and about 3 foot in stature, whose costumes he described in detail. Mostly, the spirits came to him when he was in bed and encouraged him to dream, during which they suggested various actions which he subsequently took, including courting the member of a local gentry family who became his wife. On the other hand, on one occasion, they threatened to kill him if he went to sleep, while in general their visitations led to diarrhea and other physical side effects, which led him to describe the whole experience as one he would have avoided if he had had a choice. The earliest printed reaction to Beaumont's book, of which I'm aware, appeared in 1709 in The Natural History of Superstition by the deist author John Trenchard. This has been singled out by Justin Champion as a key work in the deist critique of Orthodox religion. And Trenchard was typical of such authors in being outspokenly hostile to magical beliefs at a time when Orthodox figures were more pusillanimous. In part, he blamed such beliefs on priestcraft, on fraud and manipulation by crafty impostors, a typical part of the deist onslaught on what they saw as superstitious beliefs. But such manipulation was only possible because of human susceptibility, and equally central to his case was a quasi-medical argument about people's proneness to delusion. As Trenchard wrote, this ignorance of causes, etc., subjects us to mistake the phantasms and images of our own brains, which have no existence anywhere else, for real beings subsisting without us. He went on, to these weaknesses of our own and frauds of others, we owe most of the stories of conjurers and witches, spirits and apparitions, fairies and hobgoblins, and the numerous ways of divination. It was in this connection that he adduced the testimony of John Beaumont, one of the few actual instances that he cited in the course of his work, writing, a gentleman now living has given an account in print of his conversation with spirits for several years together, and closes his account with a distrust of the reality of their conversations with him, although he had said before that they appeared to him to be real. In fact, this is slightly unjust to Beaumont, since in the relevant passage of his book, he reaffirmed the reality of the apparitions, evidently in response to sceptical views like Trenchard's, which he had evidently encountered orally. Just over a century later, Don Ferriar included a much longer account of Beaumont's visions in his essay Towards a Theory of Apparitions of 1813. He considered that they show in a most astonishing manner how far the mind may be deceived without the occurrence of actual derangement. Ferriar continued, had this man, instead of irritating his mental disease by the study of Platonic philosophers, placed himself under the care of an intelligent physician, he would have regained his tranquility, although he admitted that as a result, the world would have lost a most extraordinary set of confessions. In fact, unbeknown to Ferriar, Beaumont had consulted an eminent doctor, in this case, one of the best-known medical men in 18th century England, the physician and collector Sir Hans Sloane. And we know about the encounter between the two men because Sloane wrote it up after Beaumont's death. This took the form of a manuscript memoir of Beaumont that Sloane sent to the French savant, the Abbé Jean-Paul Bignon, at the Académie des Sciences, ostensibly as the possible basis for an éloge of Beaumont. Since, in addition to his treatise on spirits, Beaumont had made a significant contribution to the geological debates of the day, this was not an implausible ambition. But if this was Sloane's aim, the text that he compiled was a strange one, since after just a few paragraphs outlining Beaumont's geological writings, he moved on to a lengthy description of his encounters with spirits. Sloane then devoted the rest of his text, by far the bulk of it, to other cases of supposed spiritual intercourse, which he saw as comparable to Beaumont's experiences, giving a medical disquisition on the mental disorder that he saw as involved in such cases. I'll return to that shortly, but here I want to point out the extent to which the cases that Sloane described were ones that related to manuscripts that he treasured in his famous collection. These were items associated with figures like the Elizabethan occultists John Dee and Simon Forman, with the 17th century astrologers William Lilly and Elias Ashmole, and with other more shadowy figures in Restoration London, whose manuscripts Sloane acquired. The memoir of Beaumont, which I've now published, thus constitutes an important personal testament on Sloane's part as to why he collected material of this kind, and it may even be for this reason that he wrote it. This is important because it's often been supposed that in his assiduous activity in collecting magical manuscripts, Sloane himself displayed a closet enthusiasm for the kind of practices that they chronicled, thus exemplifying the occultism of the period which John Fleming and Paul Monod have studied. In fact, however, Sloane took exactly the opposite view. In his opinion, these manuscripts exemplified the folly of those who had compiled them. In the case of one text by Simon Forman, which he had seen but not managed to obtain, he considered that it would be worth procuring to see the madness contained in it. And his accounts of the magical seances and the like that lay behind the books that he acquired, such as copies of the notorious Key of Solomon, were retailed in a flippant, dismissive manner. It's also interesting that in the course of his memoir, he extrapolated to other related beliefs, including witchcraft, which he clearly saw as having similar characteristics and stimuli. In Sloane's view, those who believed in magic were deluded, and his text represents an almost uniquely overt indictment of the beliefs and practices involved. What's more, Sloane believed that those who suffered from such delusions could be diagnosed and treated by a doctor like himself. He explicitly told Beaumont of his supposed visions that what he believed to be real with regard to the fairies was only imaginary or a strong impression of a dream. With reference to Beaumont's case, he commented more generally, I have treated several disorders of the mind or brain, and I believe that some of them stem from the fact that these people dreamt while awake, from which it becomes necessary to bring them back by giving them very strong, powerful, and harsh drugs. In the memoir of Beaumont, he collected other similar cases of those who were afflicted with this misfortune, including that of a young, very rich gentleman who had been tormented by this affliction, believing that to do so would be useful to those who want to understand illnesses of the head and of the mind. This text therefore presents a compendium of such cases, which would otherwise be hard to locate in Sloane's profuse surviving medical correspondence. Basically, Sloane seems to have seen such figures as suffering from what was defined at the time as hypochondria, a disease stemming from the lower belly or spleen, which affected the body as a whole, and the symptoms of which overlap with the traditional ailment of melancholy, so that it was sometimes referred to as hypochondriac melancholy. It was generally accepted that these symptoms could include delirium, which comprised the dreams of waking persons, wherein ideas are excited without order or coherence, and the animal spirits are drove into irregular fluctuations, in the words of Archibald Pitcairn, a pioneering mechanistic physician to whom I'll refer later. Moreover, Sloane believed that there were appropriate therapies for dealing with the illness, and he particularly advocated bloodletting and the use on such patients of strong emetics like antimony sulfide or the very bitter juice of the Azarabaca plant. In his words, these have rarely been unsuccessful in curing them within a sufficient length of time, even though the side effects of the severe treatment required often causes a lot of embarrassment, presumably because of the repeated evacuations that resulted. Indeed, Sloane's conclusion was that those who are afflicted by this misfortune can be cured just as well as those suffering from pleurisy, colic, or other similar illness. In the case of Beaumont, Sloane stated how his patient was very happy to be freed from his spiritual intercourse by the vomits and natural purgatives that delivered him. In a follow-up note to Beaumont's case, Sloane made it clear that he conflated magical phenomena like those that Beaumont and others claimed to have witnessed with the claims of ecstatic experience of members of religious sects of the period. He reported that Beaumont told me a few years before his death that in a new sect called Philadelphians, there was a brass basin which, when placed beneath the bedhead, would never fail to produce this kind of dreams or conversations. In fact, this reference has proved hard to substantiate from the writings of Jane Lead and her Philadelphian followers. If anything, the idea of brass vessels having a special role seems to have been one that Beaumont promoted himself. But this link is significant because it aligns the diagnosis of magic on Sloane's part with the explanations of religious enthusiasm as the result of mental disorder that have been commonplace since the mid-17th century, as exemplified by the writings of authors like Henry Moore and Merrick de Sorbon. Enthusiasm played a similarly prominent role in John Trenchard's critique of traditional religion in his Natural History of Superstition. And it's worth noting that medical arguments like those that both he and Sloane used were also deployed by more orthodox controversialists in the pamphlet war that greeted the French prophets, the mystics from the Cévennes, who took London by storm in the early years of the 18th century. Sloane's overt invocation of such reductive explanations in relation to magic thus had a clear pedigree. But what is notable here is the rather taken-for-granted way in which he put them forward, a trait that he shared with his medical contemporaries, as we'll see. Equally important is the accompanying belief of such men that they had the wherewithal to cure such distempers, a power which neither 17th century philosophers like Henry Moore nor deists like John Trenchard had ever claimed. The physician Nicholas Robinson, for instance, opined that the French prophets would have done much better under the hand of the physician than the secular arm. Strong purgatives, bleeding often repeated, and the discipline and management necessary in such cases would much easier have pulled down that overweening opinion of self-holiness. Another eminent doctor, Richard Mead, devoted a section of his Medical Precepts and Conditions of 1751 to conditions straddling those dealt with by Robinson and those covered by Sloane, from those who fancied they were haunted by hobgoblins to those who suffered from vain terrors and notions of divine vengeance, all of whom were to be treated by bloodletting, vomits, and the like. Indeed, a rare vignette of how those with such beliefs might become patients at the hands of a medical man is provided by the record of such cases kept by Dr. John Woodward and published after his death, which includes a detailed account of two hypochondriacs he treated, who turn out to have been suffering from a heightened religious sensibility, which he analysed in purely physiological terms and cured by the use of clysters and purges. In one of these cases, Woodward included a section comprising an attempt to explain the phenomenon mechanically, and it's important to acknowledge the extent to which doctors like these believed that medicine had been revolutionised in their era by the application of models stemming from the mechanical philosophy of the 17th century. Various authors published elaborate tomes which offered a rationale of the workings of the human body and the proper treatment of ill health according to mechanistic principles, with the aim of creating a theory of physic with the same certainty as geometry. The origins of the tradition, in fact, go back to authors like Giovanni Alfonso Borelli and Lorenzo Bellini in Italy in the late 17th century, who sought to produce a medical system based on essentially Cartesian principles, and their ideas were invoked by some of the early adherents of the tradition. But increasingly, it was Isaac Newton who came to the fore, and this represents a key example of the power of Newton's influence and the extent to which the method used in his Principia and Optics was seen as providing a model for intellectual inquiry, which was equally applicable to all aspects of nature. The explicitly Newtonian version of the tradition began with Archibald Pitcairn in the 1690s, most fully expressed in his Philosophical and Mathematical Elements of Physic, probably posthumously translated into English in 1718. He was followed by various others, including George Cheyne, John Friend, and others I've already mentioned, such as Richard Mead, who declared in his Mechanical Account of Poisons of 1702 his aim of introducing mathematical studies, that is, demonstration and truth, into the practice of physic. Or Nicholas Robinson, the explicitly Newtonian title page of one of whose books I show here. To contemporaries, such aspirations seem to align medical men with intellectual modernity, giving them a real ideological power. Indeed, doctors were arguably among the leading public intellectuals in early Enlightenment England, comparable in significance to the academics and clerics who tend to dominate accounts of intellectual life in the period. On the other hand, in many ways, medical Newtonianism strikes me as one of the more bizarre intellectual developments of its time. For one thing, those who adopted mechanistic theories of this kind all strongly disagreed with one another, viciously criticising each other's views in their books. In Richard Mead's case, he completely changed his Newtonian rationale over the course of his career, initially invoking the concept of attraction as the basis of his system, but subsequently laying a more modish stress on a universal elastic matter. And the reason for this was not least the fact that these fashionable theories really only represented window dressing. They were imposed on a therapy that remained almost entirely traditional, including purges, bleeding, and the like. Though such theorising may have been useful in differentiating doctors from quacks, in terms of medical practice, it made very little difference at all. What's more, it was from their practice rather than from their theoretical writings that the grandees of medicine in the period gained their reputation and made their fortunes. Indeed, some of the most successful such practitioners published hardly any books at all. This includes Sloane, whose only significant publication was in his Natural History of Jamaica, stemming from the time he spent in the West Indies at the very start of his career. The Beaumont memoir, which is so revealing of his attitude to magic, failed to see the light of day until the 21st century, and his views are often rather elusive. Perhaps the classic example of medical celebrity unaccompanied by publication is provided by the famous Dr. John Radcliffe, whose practice was so successful that he amassed a vast fortune, which he left to the University of Oxford, yet who published no books at all, apart from a brief set of prescriptions. Radcliffe was notorious for his wit and sarcasm, which he often deployed at the expense of wayward patients. He was also openly hostile to quacks, and it seems quite plausible that he accompanied this by an openly magical line like Sloane's. But although there were rumours to this effect at the time, these are frustratingly hard to substantiate. Obviously, it was in the interest of such men to keep a low profile on matters that were peripheral to their main professional commitments. But this means that, in general, we are left to use hints of the kind that I've been accumulating here to reconstruct an outlook that was probably nevertheless widely expressed in oral form and may well have been influential in proportion to the high public profile of these leading medical figures. This makes it all the more striking that there is one analogue to Sloane's memoir of Beaumont, which is highly relevant to my theme, and that was published at the time. And this is Richard Mead's Medica Sacra, or a commentary on the most remarkable diseases mentioned in the Holy Scriptures, published in Latin in 1749 and translated into English in 1755, which dealt directly with ostensibly supernatural phenomena of the kind that I've been concerned with here. Of course, as its title suggests, it did so primarily in connection with the Bible. And for this reason, it was a slightly surprising book for Mead to have written at all, since by doing so, he stepped right into the middle of deep theological controversy. Miracles represented a somewhat problematic topic for thinkers of the day, raising issues concerning the likelihood of supernatural intervention in the world that were similar to those that arose in connection with magical beliefs. Obviously, Protestants were united in rejecting the possibility of contemporary miracles, such as those that were supposed to have occurred at St. Medar in the 1730s. But even the miracles of Christ had been the subject of debate between radical and orthodox figures since the publication of William Woolston's notorious Discourses of the Miracles of Our Saviour between 1727 and 1729. While just a year before Mead's book was published, a similar controversy had arisen, stimulated by Conyers Middleton's iconoclastic free inquiry into the miraculous powers which are supposed to have subsisted in the Christian Church of 1748. In the meantime, in the 1730s, a further controversy had arisen over the nature of the demoniacs whose healing by Christ was retailed in the Gospels, of which the cleric Arthur Ashley Sykes gave a naturalistic explanation, about which I will be saying more shortly, which unsurprisingly brought on him the ire of more orthodox churchmen. By writing on these and related topics, Mead was asking for trouble. Indeed, he was attacked alongside Middleton by one guardian of orthodoxy, Thomas Church, vicar of Battersea and prebendary of St. Paul's, and the episode begs the question of what he thought he was doing. The answer, I think, is that he genuinely meant to do well. Though he came from a strongly nonconformist background, he was the son of a dissenting minister and a descendant of the famous Puritan divine Joseph Mead. Mead seems to have become a latitudinarian, if not even a kind of deist. He evidently believed that by offering an up-to-date medical account of medical matters in the scriptures, he would increase their credibility against their detractors, and he disavowed any irreligious intent. This was exactly the line that men like Sykes and Middleton took, and Mead thus further illustrates the spectrum between Anglican orthodoxy and deist heterodoxy that is now commonplace among intellectual historians of the period, even though none of these has thought it appropriate to include him in their account of such developments. Though it is not as directly concerned with magic as Sloane's memoir of Beaumont, I think anyone who reads Medica Sacra will be struck by its similarly naturalistic and reductionist approach. Though Mead accepted that some miracles might be genuine, he believes that the bulk of the events that were seen as supernatural in the Bible were interpreted thus due to ignorance of their true natural causes. Moreover, the book is in passing as overtly dismissive of commonplace magical beliefs as Sloane's, as in the preface where Mead expressed himself pleased to have seen the witchcraft statute abolished in 1736, claiming that witches were simply mad, and it was this that made them confess to such feats as are impossible in the nature of things. Most of his text was devoted to offering a naturalistic medical account of the various diseases and supposedly supernatural afflictions that were described in the Bible, often naming the actual complaint that he thought was involved, and sometimes even suggesting the remedies that might have been used to cure it. In the case of Saul, for instance, Mead considered that the words troubled with an evil spirit should be translated as to be mad. He diagnosed Saul's problem as melancholy and included a disquisition on melancholy, which has the passage, "Nor is their case different, in my opinion, who persuade themselves that they see ghosts and not goblins." He then went on to use almost exactly the same language as Sloane in explaining how deliriums are a kind of dreams of people awake, and the mind in both cases affects the body differently according to the nature of its object. Similarly, he explained away the symptoms of the supposed demoniacs of the New Testament as nothing but arise from a natural disposition of the body, an argument in which he could in fact claim the authority of his ancestor Joseph Mead. While in relation to epilepsy, he could quote an even older authority in the form of Hippocrates' treatise on the sacred disease, the foundation text in Western culture for a naturalist as against supernaturalist approach to affliction, which it's not surprising that men like Mead took to heart. As I've already noted, in writing Medical Sacra, Mead was using his medical credentials to enter a debate that had long been fought over by theologians. And what is interesting, if one returns to that in the light of what I've said so far, is the extent to which clerics who took an iconoclastic line used medical arguments. Arthur Ashley Sykes, both in his inquiry into the meaning of the demoniacs of the New Testament of 1737 and the further inquiry on the subject that he published in response to his critics later in the same year, certainly exemplifies this. Sykes was, of course, a learned theologian and active controversialist who had been involved in many published debates on doctrinal and other issues in the course of his career. But what's striking about these 1737 tracts that started the Demoniacs controversy is the extent to which, in addition to learned classical, biblical, and patristic allusions, Sykes also cites medical arguments and medical books in support of his case. Thus, like Mead, Sykes saw Saul's ailment as melancholy, while he argued that the invocation of demons in cases of madness seemed to be particularly associated with victims who were affected with an alienation of mind where no fever attended them, for which he used the technical term atrabilis. In response to some of his critics, he took them to task for their evident ignorance of what was commonplace to those that were acquainted with physic at all. The books that he cited included the writings of the celebrated 17th century doctor Thomas Sydenham and John Friend's History of Physic of 1725-6, as well, of course, as Galen and Hippocrates, whose sacred disease was central to his claim. It was on such grounds that he came to his forceful conclusions concerning the natural causes of many of the miraculous events that he dealt with, and it's striking how often, like Mead, he uses a dismissive language concerning magical beliefs while making his case. For instance, using almost exactly the same words as Mead in comparing a belief in demons with that in hobgoblins and spectres, or seeing supposed exorcisms as being akin to witchcraft. As he concluded at one point, what is there so wild and extravagant that superstition has not thought of? What is significant here is that it was on naturalistic and not least medical grounds that Sykes decided that a liberal interpretation of the gospel miracles was impossible. It was essentially this that led him on to the accommodationist conclusions that he drew and that were to prove so influential on later biblical criticism. In other words, the view that Christ could only be expected to speak the language of his own time in describing the ailments that he cured as representing demonic possession. Christ's role was that of the best and wisest physician, and the task of such a figure was to prevent or cure disease, not to rectify notions about it. As Sykes put it, no man conceives the design of the sacred writings to be to correct the mistakes of men in physic, more than it is in astronomy or any other art. With Conyers Middleton and his brilliant and notorious free inquiry into the miraculous powers which were supposed to have subsisted in the Christian Church of 1748, there is a somewhat similar state of affairs. Of course, Middleton's book is primarily a hatchet job on the early church fathers, whom he excoriated as enthusiasts, cheats, and forgers, in the words of one of his early critics. And it was not least Middleton's hostile characterization of men like Justin Martyr, Tertullian, and Cyprian that caused the outrage with which his book was greeted. His confrontational manner perhaps makes it unsurprising that Middleton caught the interest of the historian Hugh Trevor Roper, who clearly relished the way in which Middleton championed all free inquiries into opinions against the opposition that prejudice, bigotry, and superstition are ever prepared to give. This is, in fact, Trevor Roper's copy of Middleton's book, which I bought when his library was sold after his death. It should also be made clear that Middleton's primary argument in doing down the fathers was that of fraud, which had run alongside the reductive medical argument that I've been dealing with here since the time of the day of deists like John Trenchard, the argument that magical and related beliefs were deliberately fostered by priests and others to delude the people and thereby increase their power. Since Middleton learned so much from the deists with whom he is sometimes conflated, it's not surprising that he should echo anti-magical arguments of the kind that had long been commonplace among them. Middleton's aim, in his words, was to expose the vanity of those popular systems and prejudices which are to be found in every country, derived originally from error, fraud, or superstition, and craftily imposed upon the many to serve the interests of the few. In addition, however, when discussing the miracles that patristic authors claimed had taken place after the apostolic age, Middleton too used medical arguments. For instance, in invoking many learned men of modern times as seeing supposed possession as epilepsy, or retailing modern cures of a viper's bite by oil to show that there was nothing supernatural about it, or claiming that supposed miracles might in fact be due to the common experience of diseases curing themselves. Indeed, he similarly saw the credit of miracles in general as being inflated by ignorance of the powers of nature. Middleton also, like Sykes, cited recent examples of phenomena like ventriloquism to explain away events to which significance was attached in his sources, and he likened the enthusiasts of the early church to the French prophets and Methodists of his own day. Equally interesting is a long excursus in which Middleton used belief in witchcraft as part of his claim for the overall need for an accommodationist position. In it, he pointed out how witchcraft had once been universally believed, yet the incredibility of the thing prevailed and was found at last too strong for all this force of human testimony. The implication was, as with Sykes, that allowance needed to be made for the conditions of thought in a historical period when assessing the plausibility of the belief systems that prevailed in it. Thus, concerning miracles, and implicitly a whole swathe of ostensibly supernatural phenomena, it was only to be expected that erroneous views would prevail until challenged by the gradual improvement of science and the successive efforts of reason. A further statement of a similar position was made by one of Middleton's few supporters in the debate, the Hampshire cleric Frederick Toll, who also commented on the support that the silly, groundless stories of witches and witchcraft had had in the 16th century, even from eminent churchmen like Bishop Jewell or in Parliament, by way of illustrating how a belief in miracles in the post-apostolic period could be accounted for upon the same principle of credulity. It's perhaps worth noting that Toll, too, used medical arguments in support of his position, claiming of the patristic period that physic was at that time in a state of infancy. Hence, there's a surprising degree of overlap between the doctors and the progressive clerics whose views on ostensibly supernatural phenomena I've been considering here. And it's perhaps interesting to find that there is some evidence of links between these clerics and the medical men and deists on whom I commented earlier. Arthur Ashley Sykes was a patient of Sir Hans Sloane's, and a handful of letters from him to Sloane survive. It's interesting that at one point in his free inquiry, Sykes cited a conversation he had with an ingenious physician about the meaning of a key biblical text to which he attributed a sceptical meaning, and one wonders whether this could have been Sloane or someone like him. Here it's perhaps also worth noting that it was from Sloane that the cleric Francis Hutchinson had requested advice concerning the publication of his sceptical historical essay concerning witchcraft some years before it was actually published in 1718. In the case of Sykes and Mead, although I'm not aware of any direct links between the two, in 1749, Sykes expressed his support for Mead's Medica Sacra in a letter to the cleric and intelligencer Thomas Birch. Invoking Hippocrates and others, he observed of Mead's interpretation of demoniac as madman that all the old physicians knew the meaning of that word as well as any modern divines, and can explain it as well if I'm not very grievously mistaken. As far as Middleton is concerned, his links with Sloane seem to have been fairly minor, while with Mead they were positively antagonistic, since in the 1720s Middleton had demolished the claim made by Mead in a public oration that doctors enjoyed high status in ancient Rome. Middleton illustrated that in fact doctors were of servile status. But I've already referred to the notorious combativeness of doctors at this time over their versions of a mechanical view of medicine. And this aligned Middleton with Mead's medical antagonists, and especially with John Woodward, with whom he enjoyed a friendly relationship that led to his being appointed the first Woodwardian Professor of Geology at Cambridge in 1731. In addition, one of Middleton's closest friends, who became his executor after his death, was a medical man, William Heberden, and it's interesting to find Middleton making various heterodox comments in his letters to him. Even more interesting are Middleton's links with Thomas Gordon, the deist collaborator of John Trenchard in such publications as the notoriously heterodox Cato's Letters. Gordon married Trenchard's widow after Trenchard's death, and one of Mrs. Gordon's closest friends became the wife of Conyers Middleton, and the group spent much time together in music making and other social activities. In slightly more general terms, one might also instance the overlap between Newtonian medicine and deism in the case of the writer Thomas Morgan, whose books alternate between the two subjects, though sadly I've not been able to find much in the way of articulate anti-magical sentiment on his part. But what's more important is the nexus we seem to see here, comprising fashionable doctors with somewhat iconoclastic views, if comforting traditional therapy, and clerics who flirted with free-thinking ideas, together with the men and women with whom they mixed in the fashionable cosmopolitan circles to which they belonged. If we're trying to understand the rejection of magic that's taken for granted in documents like William Hogarth's famous Credulity, Superstition and Fanaticism of 1762, it's surely among people like these, whose attitudes on such topics were likely to be disproportionately influential, that we should be looking. Here we encounter that assurance of the utter implausibility of magical phenomena that one might expect in an Enlightenment setting. And it's perhaps revealing to find Arthur Ashley Sykes making purely metaphorical use of the demonic in a bantering letter to a correspondent of his, the medically trained cleric and antiquary Cox Macro, in 1737. Sykes complained to Macro about a word he had used, which, I quote, some demon or other must explain, unless you'll be so kind as to recollect the English word designed and let me know its meaning. Of course, this media coexisted with others, and justice needs to be done to them here. As the furore over Sykes's and Middleton's books show, for most churchmen, ideas like theirs were dangerously radical, and their treatises were greatly outnumbered by orthodox attacks on them, although I think one should be wary of measuring the significance of ideas by the extent to which they were regurgitated in print. Clearly for orthodox clerics, the kind of naturalistic and accommodationist views that such men put forward were wholly unacceptable. Indeed, it's revealing that in the course of his attack on Middleton and Mead, Thomas Church also took a more conservative position on witchcraft, countering Middleton and Mead's outright rejection of its reality by citing the more neutral position that Joseph Addison had adopted in The Spectator in 1711, in which, although admitting that he could give no credit to any particular instance of it, he nevertheless affirmed his belief that, in general, there is and has been such a thing as witchcraft. Indeed, one might argue that Orthodox churchmen were badly placed to take a lead on a matter like the rejection of magic, because there's so much magic in the Bible whose literal truth they so strongly asserted. In the case of medicine, too, not all were as radical as Sloane and Mead. An example is provided by the debate over the views of William Beckett, whose sceptical work on the royal touch, a free and partial inquiry in the efficacy of teaching for the cure of the King's Eagle of 1722, was dedicated to Sloane. In his book, Beckett explained the phenomenon in naturalistic terms, seeing its promotion as nothing more than impositions on the people, and he accompanied this by rhetoric that aligned him with the deist, glorying in the fact that, although in some former ages a freedom of thought has been misconstrued as a design to bring about some sinister ends, happy it is for us now that an unrestrained freedom of thought and a right method of reasoning have become the happy characters of this age. Interestingly, there are echoes here of Mead's comments, if I may be allowed to declare my thoughts with freedom, when invoking natural causes concerning possession in Medica Sacra. For Beckett was attacked for this, for his pains, by another doctor, Daniel Turner, in a lengthy excursus to his Art of Surgery, published in the same year as Beckett's book, as also by John Friend in his History of Physic in 1725-6, who complained how the darling notions of free thinking, carried beyond its bounds, has done a great deal of mischief in physic as well as in divinity. Even the legacy of Newton was more mixed than my account of it so far may have made it appear. Here, a key figure is William Whiston, Newton's successor as Lucasian professor at Cambridge until he was expelled from the university for heresy. For as the years went by, Whiston became more and more of a mystic, and he lined up with the Orthodox to attack both Sykes in the demoniacs controversy and Middleton in that over miracles, believing strongly in the active power of the devil in the world as much as it has in his own time as in antiquity. Indeed, it's interesting to find a mocking attitude towards Whiston on the part of Arthur Ashley Sykes, another Newtonian who was entrusted with the task of examining Newton's theological papers after his death. In his further inquiry, Sykes scorned Whiston for invoking spirits playing in the air in explaining the characteristics of the Aurora Borealis of 1716, which Whiston indeed did, seeing this as unbecoming a figure who would take it ill not to be deemed a tolerable mathematician and philosopher. Other Newtonians promoted ideas of the kind that Paul Monod surveys in Solomon's Secret Arts, including George Cheney and William Stukeley. Indeed, Monod has a whole chapter on the Newtonian Magi. And here we might note the conviction of another recent historian, David Katz, that, I quote, we need to give Isaac Newton a much bigger place in the genealogy of the occult. So predominant was the influence of Newton on 18th century thought that it led in all sorts of mutually contradictory directions. Hence, I suppose that I'm returning to a stress on the pluralism that we've come to see as characterising Enlightenment thought. And of course, this was to develop even more in the later years of the 18th century and the early years of the 19th, with the rise of Methodism and the occult revival. Yet we must be sure that we do not allow revisionism to give us a lopsided view of the period by attaching excessive emphasis to certain facets of it at the expense of others. It's all very well to hear all about the wizards, alchemists, and spiritual seekers who feature in John Fleming's and Paul Monod's books, and we even need to be aware of the soporific tomes by Orthodox clerics to which some scholars have urged us to do justice. But I think it's equally important to do justice to the rival, more sceptical traditions in the thought of the period, the milieu of which I've tried to sketch in this talk. The voice of the more sceptical of medical men in particular needs attention, and it has also been interesting to find how their attitude to magic resonated with some of the more radical ideas that emanated from clerical circles. Indeed, through the controversies that Sykes and Middleton started, even Orthodox clerics may have been forced to reconsider their ideas on such subjects, as suggested by the citation by their leading antagonist, Thomas Church, of authors like the Dutch witchcraft skeptic Balthasar Becker. What's more important, however, is the extent to which we can hear the voice of a significant portion of 18th century educated opinion, which may have been disproportionately influential, even though it's elusive in the sources. And to return to men like John Ferriar, writing in the years around 1800, with whom I began this paper, I think it has been no less important to discover a prehistory to the sceptical and reductionist attitudes towards magical phenomena voiced by men like him. This has hitherto been almost entirely overlooked by historians who have traced Ferriar's sources no further back than to Christoph Friedrich Nicolai and his well-known paper to the Royal Society of Berlin in 1799. Such an exploration of the prehistory of such ideas is surely worthwhile in giving a sense of the way in which magic became axiomatically discarded in significant sections of Enlightenment thought, an outlook that continues to have a powerful legacy today. Thank you.
What you've presented with the clandestine literature and the libertine literature of the Enlightenment. And the other one is about the role that Spinoza and Balthasar Becker have played in discussing these kind of issues.
Yeah. Yes, I mean, the trouble about a paper like this is that I have written earlier about the slightly earlier period and didn't want to repeat myself from what I said here. So in a sense, this is a sequel to things that I've written about the period before about 1720. And I would argue that in the period before 1720, the one, I mean, I allude to that here in relation to John Trenchard, but I could repeat it in relation to other free thinkers like Anthony Collins or John Toland, or a favourite of mine, although he's not very well known, John Wagstaff in the Restoration period, that these free thinkers seem to have been openly hostile to a whole range of magical beliefs in a way that Orthodox thinkers weren't. So I think the deists, speaking of England, I'll come to Becker and et al. In a moment. In England, it does seem as if it was almost axiomatic to be sceptical about magic among free thinkers in a way that wasn't true of other thinkers at all. And if anything, I think that this had the effect of inhibiting scepticism on the part of more conservative thinkers who were afraid that by being skeptical about magic, would be led down a slippery slope towards irreligious opinion. So that, in a nutshell, is what I would say about the period up to 1720 in England. As far as and Spinoza obviously is feeding that deist, you know, I mean, Spinoza with Hobbes is seen as the root of that deist tradition in England. Becker is oddly absent from the English debate, that his work has never been translated into English in full. Only the first two books out of, I think it's eight, of Becker's book have ever been translated into English. And that seemed to have elicited very little controversy in England, unlike the state of affairs on the continent, partly because there were English thinkers who attracted comment. You know, the English debate seems to have been quite insular by comparison. So the attack is on people like Hobbes or Wagstaff or John Webster, another sceptical author, rather than on people who wrote in other languages like Becker. Particularly, you know, I think the fact that Becker wrote in Dutch was a problem for English speaking authors because very few could read Dutch. So basically, I think Becker doesn't have as much effect as he might have been expected to in the English context, and therefore, and anyway, I mean, even in the Netherlands, by being sceptical about witchcraft, Becker himself gets regarded as a free thinker, a sort of free thinker. I mean, you know, completely unfairly, but it's indicative of the extent to which hostility to magic in that early period was seen as almost a symptom of free thought.
Thank you. Thank you for this very interesting and informative presentation. I understand that it was not so much about the magic, what magic meant, but about the 18th century British skeptics' construction of magic. Magic here means everything. It's such a large and fuzzy notion. It's almost identical with the irrational, encroaching upon even upon religion. Magic is not only the occult, which is actually not truly, which is not accurate, but magic is superstition, is supernatural, miracle, and you even mentioned once the term mystic used in connection with magic. So I wonder whether any of this critics of magic ever attempt to define the concept of magic before they smash it? And did they refer to any tradition of conceptualizing or discussing magic? Did they try to divide it in various categories, such as, like Diderot tried in the encyclopedia? Do they refer to any representatives of what was considered to be magic, like, I don't know, Agrippa, Paracelsus, or any of the Renaissance authors who talk about magic?
Yeah.
I'm asking this question because, yeah, magic is not only witchcraft, it's also occult, which can include also the high magic, what was called the high magic or the ceremonial magic.
Yeah.
And a lot of other phenomena which pertain to religion, or it's not clear what exactly they are. So it's very interesting to know their point of view, but one would like to know exactly if there is interest in knowing, understanding the magic, defining it, or it's just, is their own battle, is their own fight on their own front somehow a bit autistical?
Yeah. I think that's a very good point. And I think part of the reason why this debate has wider implications in the 18th century is the extent to which the people who are hostile to magic also are hostile to aspects of religion that they see as superstitious. So it goes along with a redefinition of religion along more rationalistic lines, which obviously is of concern to those who defend a more sort of supernaturalist religion on the grounds that the rationalists are on a slippery slope towards the abandonment of religion altogether. And I think it's also true that although the deists are, I mean, occasionally mention magical beliefs as extreme examples of superstition. So Collins, for instance, in his Discourse of Free Thinking, has a very interesting section on witchcraft in which he argues that that witchcraft is associated, you know, with bigotry, and there is no problem with witchcraft in countries that are free thinking, such as the Netherlands. In general, it's a sort of rather rhetorical attack on both aspects of religion that they see as superstitious and or enthusiastic, and magic all rolled into one as a similar phenomenon. So in fact, you know, in terms of a sort of forensic attempt to, well, in fact, I'm not even sure you'd expect them to differentiate occultist beliefs of a kind that people might sort of see as separate from religion, from aspects of religion that they see as dangerously superstitious, because to them they're both symptoms of the same sort of delusions that they use to account for them. Does that help to answer? I mean, it's a very interesting question. I could say more about it, but that's my brief.
Sure. How is this debate relevant to the
debate on magic? And on what is magic, on the history of magic in Europe. How is this, can you relate it to the earlier centuries and next centuries?
Of course, because it's extremely connected to that. So how about the debate on natural versus demonic magic in the beginning of the 17th century, where there was an attempt to define what magic is?
Yeah.
And here, you know, it sounds somehow natural magic has disappeared completely, and you just have the other one, demonic magic. And
yes.
Clearly they work with a different definition.
Well, I think what's happened there is that natural magic has been absorbed into nature,
mm-hmm.
and it's only left demonic magic. I mean, John Henry has written quite interestingly about this, and I'm rather inclined to agree with him,
mm-hmm.
that it's the effect of, you know, in the late 17th century, that natural magic is so fully absorbed into the sciences period that it leaves the demonic in a sort of newly, anomalously exposed position that it hadn't been in before. And it's actually very interesting that one thing, I'm not very good at doing kind of electronic word searches, but one thing that I've noticed but can't claim to have systematically surveyed is the extent to which the word preternatural
mm-hmm.
comes to be seen by the early 18th century as a simple synonym for supernatural and completely lacks the ambivalent status that it had had in the 16th and 17th century. But as I say, that someone really ought to do a proper study of that. But I think it's a symptom of the same thing, that basically natural magic and the concept of a kind of intermediate preternatural realm between the natural and the supernatural gets disappeared.
We have a long list of people waiting for questions. So Lavinia is, I think, first on that.
Hi, I have a very short question. Thank you for your presentation. I was wondering about your methodology. How did you choose these people as the representatives of magic thinking and enlightenment?
Good question. In a way, this paper grew from discovering the manuscript by Sloan, the text by Sloan about Beaumont. Because I was amazed by that when I discovered it, because it was implicitly define magic. Sorry, going back to your question, you know, he sees the sort of experiences that Beaumont claimed to have had, which are experiences of spiritual beings in a somewhat neutral way. You know, I mean, it's not sort of anti-religious, and yet they're not. They don't have any religious affiliation. And yet, you know, maybe I need to go back to the Sloan text and see if I can construct a kind of definition of his view of magic from that. But he then extrapolates from that, you see, two phenomena that he sees as related. And I suppose in a way I've been following along from there and extrapolating outwards from Sloan. And so this paper is in a sense an extrapolation from that initial Sloane text that I discovered and published. It's actually available online, not wholly appropriately, on the Boyle website, because it was the easiest way for me to get it into circulation. So if you go to the Boyle website under the publications of the Boyle Project, you will find an edition of this text by Sloane. And you know, I basically just read around from that, and this has developed from that. So, you know, having found Sloane, I then thought, this is really interesting. So I then started reading medical authors and was interested to discover the extent to which Mead shares a similar outlook, and then found other examples of that too by just reading around. And then was interested to find this sort of overlap with these clerical thinkers who had often been accused of being dangerously rationalistic in their accounts of related phenomena. In this case, it has to be said, I was slightly cheating, because these are more the sort of supernaturalist parts of religion rather than overtly magical things. But they again make the same juxtaposition. So, you know, Mead compares the treatment of demoniacs with magical healing. So it sort of grew like that. So I hope that. But you know, I mean, in a way, I suppose this is how research goes.
I'm wondering about enthusiasm. You mentioned enthusiasm because I mean there seems to be a debate internal to the church, Christian theologians, about what enthusiasm is, and it's sort of epistemic legitimacy. And yet it also seems to have a foot into the sort of skepticism about magic in general. So you talk a little bit about that. It just seems to be there's sort of points of overlap where you have, in a sense, skeptical writers within the Christian tradition who may accept miracles or may accept some things, but in fact are very opposed to enthusiasm.
Enthusiasm. I deliberately haven't tried to tease that out too carefully, because I don't have any particular interest in doing so. I suppose, I mean, the defining feature of enthusiasm in a religious context is the claim of some sort of direct spiritual inspiration from God, which comes directly to individual people, which others lack. And obviously this is potentially threatening particularly to the ecclesiastical authorities, because it seems as if almost anyone can bypass them if they so wish. I mean, you could claim that magic, in the sense of the claims of witches or others, has a similar sort of destabilizing effect, because of the claim that all people who shouldn't have power are obtaining it through, in their view, an access to some sort of supernatural powers of obscure origin.
But also,
in the view of the Orthodox, of the devil.
Also, medical explanations of the phenomenon.
Yeah.
But
I think the medical explanation, I think, doesn't really change very much after classical antiquity. I mean, I think Galen essentially has a view of mental illness which is pretty similar to those that people like Mead and Sloane are adopting in the 18th century. I mean, that's what why I think the whole medical side of it is. I mean, perhaps one could be more scathing about the position of the medical writers than I perhaps was in my talk, because it seems to me the whole thing is a complete fantasy. You know, I don't think you can have a Newtonian. I don't think there can be such a thing as a Newtonian medicine. I mean, the human body isn't like a model of the universe. Well, I mean, in terms that they, you know, it's not a sort of hydraulic system like the and basically, when you look at how they were defining this and what they believed, what they did in an attempt to cure the beliefs of someone like Beaumont, is just exactly what Galen would have done. So, you know, their claim to modernity is completely spurious, put it like that, which is quite interesting in terms of, you know, potential claims about the significance of Newtonianism in changing ideas in the period. You know, that people just change them, they invoke Newton, but it isn't really a Newtonian phenomenon at all. Mm-hmm. Anyway, don't want to get into that.
Veronica?
My questions are also a follow-up in order to clear the picture. So I was wondering, firstly, they actually reject completely the ontological possibility of evil, as in the classical demonology, ancient, the fathers of the church, which actually accepted the existence of devil, or they don't completely. And is there any kind of difference, a clear difference between the pathological religious feeling and the non-pathological religious feeling? And if there is such a difference, where is it? And a third question would be, I think all these criticism of religion, especially those in the already in the 18th century, in the middle of the 18th century, were as in a contextual terms, which had some concrete reference, like in, for instance, the conflicts and disputes between confessions, like Protestants and Catholics, and accusing each other of fantasies and enthusiasm, etc. And also there was a historical debate about the origins of religion in general and religion sentiment and religion religious feeling. And there were all these discussions about modern pagans, like savages, for instance, and ancient pagans, like the Greeks and all the others, which believe in many gods. And I was wondering if there is any context nurturing all these debates in medicine about religious feeling.
I mean, those are very interesting questions. I'm not very sure that I am able to answer them. In terms of sort of taking the point about the fathers, and I'm not an expert on the fathers, but I did enjoy reading Middleton's Free Inquiry into the Miraculous Power Sustained by the Church, which is a wonderful piece of academic intellectual iconoclasm at the expense of the fathers, who he does, I think, see as being somewhat similar to those who would be defined as enthusiasts in his own period. So there's, you know, there's sort of a continuity and perhaps overlap there. I should also state that, I mean, my entire terms of reference are in terms of a Protestant sort in England, who take it for granted that the sorts of phenomena that you get in France in the same period, you know, the convulsions at Saint-Médard and things like that, are laughable, really, and don't take them seriously at all. What the Catholic equivalent of this debate would be, I'm not quite sure. I mean, all I can say about, just on the Protestant-Catholic side, there are certain books on magic written by French Catholic authors in this period, which are anti-magical, but they're anti-magical in a much more traditional way of accepting, you know, of accepting rather than rejecting the reality of the devil, and yet condemning practices which are seen as being anyway associated potentially with the devil. So in contrast to the way in which Protestant thought is developing by this period, in which basically most thinkers are implicitly taking for granted that even if the devil exists, he has no power in the world, and indeed in Christ's time, effectively. I think Catholic thinkers are on a completely different wavelength, which I haven't really tried to do justice to in what I've said. So that, I'm afraid, doesn't answer all your questions, but it's an attempt at some of them.
It is, of course, ironic that Henry Moore features in the story that you're reconstructing here as a productive interpreter of enthusiasm,
yeah,
since he's also a contributor to that very interesting text of the 1670s or 80s, Joseph Glanvil's Sabbath, Christmas, Triumphalis.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is, of course, a treatise arguing for the existence of witches,
yeah,
and apparitions and ghosts.
Yeah.
But the question starting from that is, in that treatise, Glanvil has a double strategy.
One is to argue philosophically, as it were, for the existence of ghosts and apparitions,
yeah,
following arguments, Cambridge Platonist arguments about the analogy of nature and stuff like that. So that's one strategy. The second strategy is, you might say, a natural historical. He has a long collection of reports,
yeah,
that are assessed with all the modern, by the modern standards of experimental assessment of testimonies.
Yeah.
So in point of the methodology used by these people, natural history seems to be used both for arguing for the existence of ghosts and, in your examples, as one of the titles pointed out, for the non-existence of such things, or for their delusional character. Now, does this mean that first question is natural history used, I wonder, in this pro-ghost fashion, let's put it like that, in the alternative, the traditionalized, the traditionalist line of thinking, the alternative to your story, in more text than just Glanville's? I just wonder, perhaps you know. Second question would be, is there a shift? Could we talk about the shift in the use of natural history as a genre, as a methodology, with regard to these questions, say from the 17th to 18th centuries, one that adds to it this naturalizing aim that it had not had before?
No, I agree that Moore is on the face of it slightly inconsistent on this, and I think that's one. Well, let me answer the part of your question that I feel like I'm more equipped to answer, and that is that I think Glanville and Boyle and Moore, it's not just in the work he did on Glanville's book, but in his own Antidotes Against Atheism. I mean, he has a whole book of the kind of narratives that Glanville continues to accumulate, on the grounds that you know, through natural history, you could as easily prove the reality of the supernatural as natural phenomena. I mean, Boyle is absolutely explicit about that, through careful empiricism, aka the history, you could prove that there genuinely was a supernatural realm, which therefore could be, in a sense, could be used in defense of the existence of God. And I think there is a kind of revival. So this again is taking us back to the period that I haven't been addressing in this paper, but have addressed before, and can put you onto if you'd like to read more about it. But I think that in the period of Boyle and Moore and Glanville, the effect of this, as it were, free thinking challenge to the reality of an active supernatural realm is to lead to a kind of revived or renewed supernaturalism,
mm-hmm,
for a whole generation,
mm-hmm,
which is represented by books of the kind that I've just been mentioning. But I think that increasingly that goes out of fashion in the 18th century, and one that people, the predominant line of, you know, naturalism supersedes supernaturalism. People just don't actually want to believe in a supernatural activity for reasons that I don't particularly want to get into, discuss with you later. And therefore, you know, that line of argument just really more or less peters out in favour of a renewed naturalism. I hope that's a sort of starter answer, but I think that is a very interesting issue.
Is Hume ever involved in natural history?
Well, Hume. Hume obviously wrote about miracles. I haven't found much apart from the essay on miracles that relates directly to this. And in many ways, I find Middleton a more interesting. I may say this: a more interesting writer on miracles than Hume. You know, everyone reads Hume, but I think they should read Middleton.
Just to press this point a bit further. Again, for this tradition of the 17th century discussion of supernatural events,
one of the driving forces is to distinguish between true supernatural events and fake supernatural events.
Yeah.
So there is a lot of theorizing on how you distinguish between a true miracle and a fake miracle, how you distinguish between a true apparition and a fake apparition. And natural history is one answer to this, because that's empiricism, okay? So you just go
yeah.
by testimonies and experiment and so on. But
yeah.
then there is also the history of religion, and for example, Newton is very much interested in distinguishing between true and fake miracles in the past.
Yeah.
Constructing the whole methodology of this and so on. So the naturalization of the explanation goes hand in hand with the attempt to both define what is magic and what is, well, what's the territory for magic, let's say, and with the attempt to save true miracles, true apparitions, true whatever, in that place where you can save them, either as miracles in the past or as supernatural phenomena that are well testified and somehow, or the story about witches. So there are some realms here and there where by exercising your skeptical attitude and eliminating
yeah.
all the medical problems and whatever faith,
yeah.
You get to the truth of the matter.
Yeah.
Okay, that's a very Newtonian methodology in the history of religion, for example. Okay, just by eliminating all the faith
yeah.
reports of various sources in the faith tradition. Okay, those who were in the 4th century going on the wrong direction, and they just somehow moved away from the true religion. Just by eliminating them, you go back to the true miracles and so on,
mm.
the true prophets and so on. When was this lost? Was it
mm.
ever? I mean,
well, I do think, I mean, in many ways, I think in the course of the 18th century, in thinkers like Sykes and
mm-hmm.
Middleton, you are actually moving towards a more almost complete denial of
but then the driving force might have been different.
Yeah, well, I think they actually want such a rationalistic religion that there's no room for the supernatural in it. And therefore they go back to their sources and find that they can come up with natural explanations. I mean, it seems to me the advantage of the medical account of how miracles happen is that you can actually apply it to almost everything, a sort of psychosomatic explanation. I don't read the literature on such subjects, but I'm sure that someone has applied a psychosomatic explanation to every miracle in the New and Old Testament and proved that there was nothing supernatural in them at all. And in a sense, that's the implication of what people like Sykes and Middleton are doing. And it's the implication of going back to Ferriol with whom I started. I mean, it seems to me that his explanation in terms of mental misfunctioning, if you like, can explain away everything you don't want to believe in at all, regardless
mm-hmm.
of
yeah.
the supposed
mm-hmm.
empirical evidence
yeah.
that might seem
yeah.
supportive.
Mm-hmm.
So in a sense, it's a kind of presumption that if you have these if you have these principles that you can apply, that you dismiss everything that is not consistent with them.
Mm-hmm.
Sort of trumps the more open-minded empiricism
mm-hmm.
that had characterized the late 17th century when as it were the testimonies of supernatural events seemed to provide real evidence that would later be dismissed.
Mm-hmm.
Just a short question: is Swedenborg? Do you know Swedenborg?
I'm afraid he's on my speed table. But you'll find a bit about him in Paul Moyer's book on the archive. If I'm perfectly honest, this paper really sort of,
I used Ferriol as a kind of frame for it. But really, I'm most of the developments that interest me are in the early 18th century rather than the late 18th century, and you know, Swedenborg is really a bit late for me.
no more pressing questions, maybe we can move the discussion into a less formal environment. So let's thank Michael first for this. We are going to go together to Siegfried Priory, 10 minutes from here, so just hang around.